We previously discussed the production process of crystalline silicon wafers, starting with quartzite as raw material and ending with electronic-grade silicon. In this video, we will show which elements are used to facilitate impurity doping in crystalline silicon. We will discuss the doping concentration and the effect on the concentration of electrons and holes, and we will discuss how doping will affect the position of the Fermi level in the energy band diagram and the band gap of the material. In the introduction video on silicon, we have discussed that silicon has 4 valence electrons and that in crystalline silicon, each silicon atom bonds to 4 other atoms. Silicon is therefore listed in the periodic table of elements under group 4, as indicated by the Roman number 4. The electronic properties of silicon, like the conductivity, can be manipulated by adding impurities to the material. This process is called doping. When adding dopant atoms, silicon atoms in the lattice will be replaced by these dopant atoms, and this is called substitutional doping. The most common element that is used to dope silicon p-type is boron. Boron is a group 3 element and has 3 valence electrons. When boron substitutes an atom in the silicon lattice, it will miss 1 valence electron and will therefore accept an electron from the crystalline silicon lattice, which implies that it leaves a hole in the valence band. As boron accepts an electron, it is referred to as an acceptor-type dopant in silicon. The result is that holes will be the majority carriers in the material. Another group 3 element that is frequently used as p-type dopant is aluminium. It can be introduced in the crystalline silicon lattice in the process of making contacts on the cells. This will be further discussed in another video. To obtain n-type doping, phosphorus can be introduced, which is a group 5 element and has 5 valence electrons. When phosphorus substitutes a silicon atom in the lattice, the remaining electron is donated to the conduction band and n-type silicon is obtained. Phosphorus is therefore called a donor. In an n-type semiconductor, electrons are the majority charge carriers. The concentration of doping atoms ranges from 1 in a billion silicon atoms for light doping up to 1 in 10,000 silicon atoms for heavy doping. The latter implies a doping concentration of 5 times 10 to the power 18 dopant atoms per cubic centimeter. Standard crystalline silicon wafers are often doped with a concentration of about 1 times 10 to the power 16, which results in a resistivity of about 1 to 2 ohms centimeter for both P and N-type wafers. Now that we have discussed the microscopic view of impurity doping in crystalline silicon, we move our discussion to the effect of doping on the energy band diagram and energy level for this material. In the PV energy conversion course, we have already shown that for a semiconductor, the electron concentration is related to the energy difference between the Fermi level EF and the conduction band edge EC and the effective density of states of the conduction band NC with the expression shown on this slide. Here we assume that the Boltzmann approximation is valid, meaning that the Fermi level is more than 3 times kBT below the conduction band. The approximation of the Fermi-Dirac distribution function by the Boltzmann distribution function is a safe assumption at room temperature. We can find a similar expression for the hole concentration relating to the energy difference between the Fermi level and the valence band edge EV and the effective density of states of the valence band NV. When doping atoms are introduced in the crystalline silicon lattice, the charge carrier concentrations will be affected. At room temperature, there is enough thermal energy to ionize all donor and acceptor impurities. This is called complete ionization and implies that for n-type silicon, the electron concentration can be taken to be equal to the effective donor concentration, and for p-type silicon, the hole concentration is equal to the effective acceptor concentration. we can now obtain the position of the Fermi level that is directly related to the donor or acceptor concentration as follows. In the band diagram of n-type crystalline silicon, the Fermi level will therefore be shifted towards the conduction band, while in the p-type silicon, the Fermi level will be closer to the valence band. This graph shows how the Fermi level steadily moves towards the conduction and valence band when the donor and acceptor concentrations are increased for n-type and p-type crystalline silicon respectively. As was discussed in the PV energy conversion course, when forming a p-n junction for making a solar cell, the open circuit voltage of the solar cell depends on the level of quasi-Fermi level splitting and is ultimately controlled by the doping concentrations in the quasi-neutral regions of the device. This implies that if the doping concentrations in both the N and P-type material are increased, the level of the quasi-Fermi level splitting and thus the VOC of the cell will be increased. But Tom, why wouldn't we increase the doping concentrations even more to get the most out of the band gap of crystalline silicon? The answer is as follows. If the doping concentration is larger than the effective density of states of the corresponding band, we can no longer use the Boltzmann approximation to calculate the position of the Fermi level. Actually, the position of the Fermi level would be above the conduction band energy EC or below the valence band energy EV, instead of being placed more than 3 kBT below EC or above EV. An effect that will then play an important role is band gap narrowing, where the band gap of the semiconductor is reduced for very high doping concentrations. As an example, the band gap of crystalline silicon will be reduced by 0.12 electron volts when the donor concentration equals NC. This will completely overshadow the apparent advantage of increasing the open circuit voltage by increasing the doping concentration. To summarize this video, we have discussed the most frequently used donor and acceptor elements to make doped crystalline silicon. We have shown that the position of the Fermi level will shift towards the valence or conduction band upon increasing the doping concentration. And finally, we have discussed the band gap narrowing effect in silicon, which will occur for very high dopant concentrations.